so glad to have you here this morning. We're glad to have those that are joining us online as well. And what a blessing it is to have you all here today. Amen?
Amen.
We're going to start out singing the song, Great and Mighty is the Lord our God.
No, we're not going to start out singing that.
All right.
I overruled you on that. Tomorrow is our pastor's birthday. So we're going to sing happy birthday first. Happy birthday. Y'all join me as we sing our pastor for his birthday. How old are you?
I don't know.
That means you're getting too old. All right, here we go.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Thank you. Great and mighty.
Glad to have you guys joining us online as well. Pastor Rob, my mom, Mom Stender, Mom Cronin, Mom Dad, Dad Cronin, Dad Stender, Pete, Laura, whoever's watching. Glad to have you there, here today. We're going to say hi to Doc. Doc, can you say hi to everybody online? Say hi, wave at them. Dot saying hi to y'all. Leo, you gonna say hi to everybody online?
Hi everybody.
Say hi to
everybody.
You gotta say hi to the people in the Philippines.
Yes.
Say hi to the people in the Philippines.
Hi. Hi, Philippines.
Father, I pray that you might just challenge our hearts through the word, through the message, and through the singing today, Lord. And we'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Do you want to stand or sit?
Oh, I think so, then. Yep, sit down. I don't know what I'm going to do this morning. I got too many things on my mind this morning. We, one thing I do want to mention before we get this next song is Heritage Day. Brother Bill mentioned it earlier in our Sunday school time. And how many people know what Heritage Day means at Calvary? Okay. I see a lot of hands that weren't raised. So I had an idea, and that's usually pretty dangerous when I have an idea. We need a model. We need some models to bring to next Sunday to dress like you would dress for Heritage Day the following Sunday. And just kind of dress like you would normally dress for Heritage Day and come up and kind of where the people can see what we're supposed to look like. We've never done this before, but I think it'd be a good idea because it's been a while since we've had a successful Heritage
Day. You know what, Lex, I've learned? From a wise man.
No, I don't want to hear that. I'm not
that said the guy that comes up with that idea is the one that needs to do it.
Well, I think
are you all in favor of that?
The old part I'm good with. I can meet that criteria, but I don't know that I have the outfit for it. But I think of Edie and Charles, they're good at that. No? We need a couple of models. We need a husband, wife, mom, or it could be young people. But think about that. We'll give you, we'd like to have a preview of a Heritage Day dress for next Sunday. And then the next Sunday we'll all, you know, be prepared for what we need to look like. So just a thought, and it would be a good idea, I think, but I don't know how we're going to play it out. Anyway. Don't forget about, and Pastor's probably going to announce this later, but we got a big fish fry coming up Wednesday night. So we got plenty of fish. Brother Bill's already talked about that in the Sunday school time. But we'll be cooking fish out here Wednesday at probably 5 or so, isn't that right, Brother Bill? And getting ready to go eat at 6:30, is that right? 6:30, I believe, is the time.
Johnny's got his hand up.
Saturday, 21st.
Oh.
Cleanup day.
Okay.
We
maybe fishing season will be over by then.
Daylight is dark.
All right, let's get in our next song here. Worthy is the Lamb.
Oh,
Now, as we've already had some of the announcements, we do have a fish fry on Wednesday night, okay? And my wife was busy catching grouper yesterday, and my son and myself. And so we've got plenty of grouper for Wednesday night. You know how much grouper is in the store? $33 to $35 a pound. It's pretty expensive. But we're going to bring it Wednesday night. God, Lord bless us. My wife was sitting there fishing. I put some stuff on her pole. I don't know if I did or my son did then. And she put the pole in the water, and the next thing, her pole was under the boat. She had two fish on the line before I even got a pole in the water. And so she caught a big 28-inch one, 26, 23. We had to throw him back. But the Lord bless us. We caught our limit on grouper yesterday. So we only had to go out about 3 miles. So that was pretty cool. So we got grouper. They're in the freezer, Brother Bill. And so we got grouper. You got some what?
River? There's some rim and shell because they're processed. You can't even sell them.
Prices.
And we got some mullet, $2 a pound.
He's got a mullet as well. Okay, so we've got fish, and we need people to come and eat them. Okay, how many of you can come and eat some fish on Wednesday night? All right, good. All right, so we'll have grouper for you and all that other good stuff as well. So be looking for that. You've got your little slip there. Fill it out, put it in the offering plate as well. In your bulletin, you have a letter from Jeffrey and Sydney. Okay, Jeffrey and Sydney sent me a letter this last week, and there are missionaries that are on the Amazon River. And if you love the fish, if you love to hunt, you need to just go on down to the Amazon River with Jeffrey. He's talking about the catfish migration. And they went out, and he said he loaded the boat. I don't know what loaded the boat. I don't think they have any fishing regulations there on the Amazon. They were loading the boat with catfish. But anyway, so we need to pray for Jeffrey and Sydney, and they kind of connect with us as well. So please lift them up in prayer as you go to the Lord in prayer. As I look around the congregation today, I think about the people that I'm praying for on a regular basis, and I see all the faces here, and what a blessing it is to see them as well. Saturday the 21st, we've got a church cleanup, as Johnny said, and Johnny said he's going to bring some donuts for that, right? Amen. Okay. And all the other good stuff. Then we've got our Heritage Sunday coming up in a couple of Sundays. But before that, we have our trunk or treat going on. And Laura, do you want to say something about trunk or treat?
That's a lot of spots open before I find you.
All right. Some sign-ups there. And Charles and Eve, did you all put up the sign out front?
We did.
It looks great. Great job on that. A great, great job, and we appreciate that. Trunk or Treat's going to be a great time. Heritage Sunday, we're going to have a meal following the morning service, and that's also the deadline for Christmas backpack. Yes, ma'am.
I need to meet with the food service committee next Sunday morning after church, just for a few minutes. And then also they need to be prepared to do what is necessary on Saturday.
Sounds great. At this time, I'm going to have the men come forward for the morning gifts of tithes and offerings. If I talk too much longer, I'm going to be shorting myself on the message. Johnny, why don't you bless the offering this morning?
Gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you and praise you and love you today, Lord. We thank you for this time together with friends and neighbors and Christians and alike, Lord. We just thank you, Lord, for the love of Calvary Baptist Church for others. And we pray, Lord, for all our missionaries and Jeffrey and Sydney down in the Amazon and others out there, Lord, in the Philippines. We just pray, Lord, that you'll just bless their efforts, Lord, with serving you in those countries, Lord, and just bless me with them. And Lord, we ask you to just be with the people in Israel and in that area over there, Lord, and help those people and bless them and protect them and watch over them and help this thing to end soon, Lord. And just watch over us all as we try to serve you, Lord. Thank you for Calvary Baptist Church. Help us to be a light and a witness in the community for Jesus. Thank you for our pastor. Thank you for all those years he's been here, Lord, and we thank you for him. Thank you for his family. And ask you, Lord, now to be with us today and just bless each one of us and bless this offering and bless the gift and the giver. And pray it all in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Yeah. That's God's grace. But would this be enough? You think? Yeah. But you know what? It's also enough for you to share. So like, this is enough for me and you and you and you and a few of them. And we got enough to share. We can share with people we know, people we don't know. And remember, that grace is compassion and caring and love and mercy. So, you know, if you were to take God's grace and you were to share it, you would be like this guy. You know him? The Cookie Monster. Okay? But that's just a cute way to show you, like, what God's grace is. And it's something that we need every day, every day. And we have enough to share. Okay? Let us pray. Please help us to share our grace with others. And Lord, thank you also for chocolate chip cookies. Amen.
Let's stand one more time for our next song, Wonderful, Merciful Savior. Stand.
Championship game, I do this, close your eyes, block out everything. I said,
Imagine that ball getting tossed into the air, the start of the game. And then we start to talk through. I want you to block out everything that's going on in your world today. Everything that the cares that are on your mind, the deer that are walking under your tree stand right now, all right? All those different things. I want you to think about the grace of God today. I want to talk about a topic that I don't feel like I'm fully qualified to talk about. The grace of God. God's grace has been defined as God's riches at Christ's expense. You think about the riches of God that are given to us. It's also been described as the undeserved favor of God given to undeserving people. How many of us have experienced the grace of a law officer given to us? Some of us have. Other people are confessing. Yes, okay. All right, yes. We've experienced being given grace as a parent, as a teacher, as a coach, as a just an individual. I'm sure you, as well as myself, have all experienced what it's like to give grace or to extend grace to somebody around us, somebody that doesn't deserve it, and yet we give them grace as a result. But what about as a sinner, as a mistake maker, as a self-centered person, as a lawbreaker, as an unperfect individual, as someone in need of forgiveness? Do we know what it's like to experience God's grace being given to us as well? God's grace. Amazing. I stop and you think about God's grace. Can we really understand the magnitude of God's grace? Do we fully understand the impact of God's grace? Can we really understand the riches that are given to us because of His grace? I don't think so. Because all that we can see is just the tip of the iceberg of God's grace in our limited understanding. God's grace is as great as the universe and beyond. His matchless grace, unmatched, unmeasurable. If we could measure God's grace, we would still get it wrong. Because it can't be measured. Take your Bibles today, and we're going to start in Acts chapter 11, verse 23, and you're going to have to be on your toes today, because we are going to take an exploration journey through God's Word and look at God's amazing grace. We're going to see what God's grace, what the visible grace of God looks like, and how we can let it shine in us as well. Acts chapter 11, verse 23. A well-known preacher said this: the grace of God may be invisible, but the effects of God's grace can be readily seen. Folks, listen, we may not be able to see God's grace. Obviously, His grace lived out on the cross was visible to those that were there. But the grace of God, when it touches a soul, it ought to show in our life. We're going to talk about God's grace today. Acts chapter 11, verse 23. We saw last week when Barnabas went up to Antioch to see what God was doing there in the city of Antioch. This church at Antioch was
was doing some amazing things. The Jews and the Gentiles, they were all worshiping together. There was no division. There was no segregation. It was all come together. And they were worshiping God. And so they sent Barnabas up there to check it out. And in verse number 23, when Barnabas arrived, it says who? When he came and had seen the grace of God. He saw the grace of God. Maybe on your way to church this morning, you saw something. Maybe yesterday you saw something. I was talking to a man here in our congregation. He said, I watched a spike buck walk right underneath of my stand yesterday. He saw that. Barnabas saw the grace of God. It was visible to him. Grasp that meaning. Grasp that in your life. What did he witness here? He witnessed the effects of God's grace working in the hearts of believers. What is this grace that impacts people in such a way in their life that it's seen by those around us? I want you to think of God's grace as the riches of Christ at God's expense. I should say, the riches of God at Christ's expense. I want you to think about the riches of God right now. His love. His forgiveness. His dwelling place. His presence. What about His listening ear? His guiding omniscience. His eternal protection. His never-failing care. What about the riches of His faithful word? What about His always faithful promises? And yet, I've just hit on a few things that are just the tip of the iceberg of God's grace in our life. God's grace was shown and given to us by His Son, through His Son, Jesus Christ, on the cross. John 3:16, let's quote this one together. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's God's grace made visible to us. Barnabas witnessed this grace of God alive and active in these believers. This grace that they were so blessed with was something that they accessed through Jesus Christ. You accessed this building through those doors or through this door over here. I don't think anybody came through the windows today. All right. You accessed, these individuals accessed this grace of God through faith in Jesus Christ and His finished work on the cross, just as we can. Take your Bibles and turn to Romans chapter 5. All right, turn to Romans. Or you can just do this number with your phone. All right. If you're going to do this number with your phone, make a squeaky noise like that, so we need to know that that's going. Romans chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. Amazing verses, but I want you to grasp this. And I want you to see this so that it's not just coming from Brother Rob. It's God's Word. Romans chapter 5, verses 1 and 2 says this. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have, here's that word, access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope and glory of God. Now we're going to get back to this verse here in just a moment, but I want you to walk with me. All right. How is this possible to have this grace in our life? This grace is possible by faith and by God's grace. Ephesians 2, 8, 9. You know this by heart. Let's quote it out loud. For by what? Grace are ye saved through faith. And that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. All right? We access this grace by faith in Jesus Christ. That's how they accessed this faith. I want you all to stand up. Everybody, let's stand up. All right? Stand up real quick. All right? I want you to kind of turn around and look at that bench that you're sitting on, and I want you to wiggle it. All right? Because we've... Come on, wiggle it. Do a good job. Wiggle it. Get it going. All right? I didn't see any of you doing that when you came in here. Don't sit down yet. I'm watching you. All right. You didn't wiggle that thing because you didn't have any doubts about that thing holding you up. Now, if I had you all sit down in a moment and I asked you to wiggle, Charles and Brother Johnny would be going, oh no, something's going to fall over in here. All right. And that. But listen, when you looked at Jesus Christ, when you looked at His Word, and you saw what the gospel was, you looked at it, and then you sat down by faith and trusted in Christ's finished work. So I want you to sit down in faith. All right? We have this thing where we call... This is pretty wobbly. All right? But you trusted the finished work of Christ by faith. Did you catch that? All right? And God's Word says here, when we trust Him by faith, it says here, in Romans chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. Alright? Look at that. It says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And then it goes on, by whom also we have access by this faith into this, what? What's the next three words? Grace wherein we what?
Stand.
Listen, I trusted Christ as my Savior by faith. Remember when Peter was preaching to Cornelius? He had to stop his message because the people that were there trusted Christ as their Savior by what? Faith. It was just a momentary thing by faith. They placed their faith in Jesus. And because you have placed your faith in Jesus Christ, you can stand in His grace. Do you catch the picture? We stand in His grace. We come to Christ by His grace, through faith placed in Him, and in His finished work on the cross of Calvary. When we do this, we can stand. Just like I did here, we can stand declared righteous in God's presence. What does the standing in grace mean? Look at Romans chapter 5, verse 1 again. It means that we are declared righteous. I want you to grasp this truth this morning. We stand in Christ because we are declared righteous. What does that mean? It means here, verse chapter 5, verse 1, therefore being justified by faith. We aren't justified by works. We aren't justified by deeds. We aren't justified by being a church member. We're not justified by baptism. We're not justified by any other thing except by what? Faith. Faith. That's why it's not of works, lest any man should boast. When I place my faith in Jesus, it's not on me. It's on Jesus. It's Him. And He declares us justified. What does this word, justified, mean? It means It defines us as declaring someone not guilty. It means to pronounce and treat as righteous. The word justify carries this truth that the act of justification was a one-time event in the past when these believers were declared legally not guilty. Not guilty! When did this not guilty verdict ring forth? Not guilty! Because you placed your faith in Jesus Christ. I don't know about you. Amen! That ought to be exciting, isn't it? When you trusted Christ as your Savior, whether it was in a car, in a vehicle, whether it was at a church service, whether it was in your room, wherever you trusted Christ as your Savior, you were declared what? Not guilty! At that moment. You see, justification is not something that is going on now. It was something that happened and it was completed the moment you were saved. You were declared righteous. This word in this passage carries the idea that this act of justification came from an outside source. The one who justified us was an act of God. We are declared righteous, justified by an outside source. Nothing. It's not me. It's not my merit. It's not because I'm wearing clothes that look nice or anything like that. It's not because you do your hair this way or that way. It's just a gift by God because of our faith. Therefore, this act of justification came. What does it mean? It means that we are acquitted of charges against Him. All of our charges, all of our guilt was transferred. It was imputed. All right? It was reckoned to the account of the sin bearer. Now, who bore our sins and our griefs? Who? Talk to me. Jesus. When you place your faith in Christ, everything changed because of that. So let me ask you this. Are you standing declared righteous by God in your life? Do you know Christ as your Savior? Have you placed your faith in Jesus like you placed your faith in that bench? You say, well, Brother Rob, that's pretty simple to do that. Yes, it is. But it cost Him His life, and it's His grace extended to us. So, as we accept His gift of grace, what does this standing in grace mean? It means that we are declared righteous. Yes. It also means that we are empowered by the Holy Spirit. Take your Bibles, turn to 1 Peter chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 5, it's towards the end of the Bible there. 1 Peter chapter 5, bear with me, folks. 1 Peter chapter 5, we studied the book of 1 Peter a number of years ago. All right. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse number 12 says this. By Silvanus, a faithful brother unto you, as I suppose, I have written briefly, exhorting and testifying that this is the true grace of God wherein ye stand. He's talking and he's finishing up his letter. He was writing to the scattered believers all over. The believers that scattered because of the persecution. Those that were driven from their homes. Peter's writing to them. And he's wanting to encourage them. And he told them in chapter 5, verse 7, to cast all your care upon the Lord. He told them in verse number 8, to be sober, to be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is walking about, seeking whom he can devour. And then in verse 12, he mentions the true grace wherein they stand. Now, think about that. Hey, cast your care on the Lord. Be vigilant. Watch out. Stand. And then he says, I want you to, he mentions the true grace wherein which you stand in Christ. What's he talking about here? This true grace wherein they stand. What's he encouraging them to do? Peter uses the words that give us the sense that he's encouraging them to stand firm, to do it. To stand firm in grace. God's grace. He's encouraging them throughout this book and in this passage here to face the trials that they meet, the difficult situations that they have in their lives, to meet them with confidence and with gallantry. He was addressing them like a good soldier of Jesus Christ to stand firm in the grace through all the various trials. He's saying, listen, I want you to hold that position and stand in the grace of God. Paul took a similar approach. And if you look in 2 Timothy, go back to your left there. 2 Timothy chapter 2. This is important. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse number 1. I hope I haven't lost you yet. All right. 2 Timothy chapter 2. I know I spoil you all the time. I preach from one passage. All right. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. Paul takes this approach to Timothy and he says, thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Jesus Christ. Be strong in the grace. Think about this. In order to stand against our foes, to stand firm, we need to be continually strengthened by the inner man. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16 talks about this. We need to allow our minds to be continually renewed by the truth of God's Word. Ephesians 4, 23 talks about this. We need to renew ourselves in God's Word daily. And we need to submit without hesitation to His control. Ephesians 5, 18. And that will allow us to walk as a believer and to stand firm as a soldier of Jesus Christ, Ephesians chapter 6. Do you catch that, folks? Listen, this grace, when we placed our faith and trust in Jesus and we stand in His grace, we have given everything. We need to stand firm in Christ. This standing in grace and understanding this is of vital importance. Why? Because Christians live every day by the grace of God. Every day. We receive forgiveness according to the riches of His grace. And His grace drives our sanctification. What does that mean? That's the process of us becoming more like Jesus Christ in our life. Paul tells us, in Titus chapter 2, verse 11, that the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions and to live upright, godly lives in our life. What's he saying? He said we're supposed to put off things in our life and we're supposed to put on Christ-likeness. And this all is an act of God's grace in our life. You see, folks, spiritual growth doesn't happen overnight, does it? 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 18, Peter says this, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Folks, we're supposed to grow in God's grace. How do we grow in God's grace? Now, if we took Edie's approach every morning, we'd look like Santa Claus all by the end of the year, probably even before the end of the year. We'd have cookies by the side of our bed and we'd be eating them all the time. All right? But how do we grow in God's grace? Growing in God's grace is of vital importance. You see, when we grow in God's grace, it transforms our desires, our motivations, and it changes our behavior. In fact, As we grow in God's grace, it empowers everything that we do in life. When the electricity goes out at home, what do you use to power up your house? The grace of God should empower our lives as a believer. That's how vital and important it is to us. We stand forgiven, we're declared righteous, but standing in grace means we need to grow in our life. Putting off and putting on, and we grow by getting into God's Word. Let me ask you this question. We stand declared righteous before God. Does that mean that we're not going to battle with sin in our life? Not at all. You see, even though we stand forgiven, declared righteous, it doesn't mean that we're not going to battle with sin. But it does mean that we will be in the battle with Jesus Christ on our side. Amen? He's right there with us. That's why we need to put things off in our life. We, in Ephesians chapter 5, and put things on. That's why in 1 John 1, 9, we need to confess our sins, because He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. This is all a product of God's grace. Barnabas saw this grace. He saw it alive and functioning. So how can this grace be seen by those around us? Well, as we said earlier, it begins with that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That's where it starts, by placing your faith in His finished work. The grace of God was made available by the precious blood of the Lamb of Jesus on that cross. 2 Corinthians 8, 9 says, the infinitely high price of redemption. It says this, that He was rich, though He was rich, yet for your sakes He became poor, that you might through His poverty become rich. 1 Peter 1, 18 and 19, for as much as ye know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition by your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish and without spot. Folks, listen. We attain this by accepting His gift. We can't earn it. Ephesians 2, 8, 9 tells us that. We don't deserve it. Romans chapter 3, verse 23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Isaiah 64, verse 6 says that all of our righteousness are as filthy rags. We have to understand that Jesus Christ paid our sin debt. Romans 5, 8, but God commendeth His love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You see, folks, it begins with that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. But that personal relationship with Him needs to grow. It needs to grow. It needs to be developed in our life. We need to get into God's Word. We need to read God's Word. We need to apply it to our lives. And when we do that, amazing things take place. You see, when you spend time listening to God's Word, reading it, when you allow it to impact your life, things will start to change within you. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 says this, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passing away. Behold, all things are becoming new. Folks, listen, it's a process that takes place. You see, the grace of God that came into your life may be invisible, but the impact of God's grace ought to be visible to those that are around you. It ought to be seen. You see, how is this grace seen? Through our changed lives, through transformed lives, transformed hearts, our attitudes that are changed, our character that's changed. These things, when they're changed in our life, people see those things. Grace is always shown as we mature in Christ. That's why Peter said to the believers, said, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let me ask you this. Are you growing in God's grace? Are you growing in such a way that it's working in and through you and out? In your actions and through your character and through your attitude? You see, folks, when God's grace impacts you in such a way that it flows in and through you, the people around you will see that you walk by faith in your life. Mark chapter 2, verse 5 says, when Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, he said, thy sins be forgiven thee. Folks, listen. People around you will see that you walk by faith. What else will they see? They will see your love and the fruit that the gospel brings forth. I want you to turn to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, if you would. Colossians chapter 1, verses 4 through 6. When God's grace impacts you, it's going to impact your love and the fruit in your life. Colossians 1, verses 4 through 6 says this. Paul's writing, he says, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love which ye have to all the saints, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof ye heard before in the word of truth, of the gospel which has come unto you, as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit, as it doth also in you, since the day ye heard of it, and knew the grace of God in truth. Colossians, in this passage here, talks about the fruit that God's, this relationship ought to bring forth. What is that fruit? Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 through 24, talks about the fruit of the Spirit, which is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with its affections and lusts. You see, folks, God's grace will be evident in you. It will bubble forth. The people around you will see that grace and peace is multiplied in you. Why? Because grace impacts your identity. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10 says, by the grace of God, I am what I am. God's grace impacts your behavior. God's grace impacts your strength for living. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. God's grace impacts your speech. Colossians chapter 4, verse 6 says, let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt. Grace, God's grace impacts your serving. God's grace impacts how you respond to difficulty and trials in your life. You see, folks, when God's grace impacts you, others around you will see it. Barnabas saw the grace of God alive in their life. He knew they were real Christians because he saw the grace of God. As a believer, the grace of God needs to be seen in your life. God's word says in Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 through 16, ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on the hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light to all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Folks, listen. The grace of God in your life should impact you such that others see it. And it radiates forth. How does God change you? Through His Word. I can't change you, but God's Word can. Amen. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 says this. Peter is talking, he says, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. He's talking to these people that are scattered all over. That you should show forth the praises of Him who hath called you out of this darkness into this marvelous light. Hey, we ought to show forth the praises of God. Let me ask you this question. There are a lot of believers today that just want to blend in. The believers in Antioch didn't blend in. They shined. They shined forth. They shined. And God's grace was evident. You know, as a believer, you can be like the Dead Sea. You can have all the grace of God flowing into your life, and then you try to hide it. And that's why it's dead. There's no outlets. But as a believer, we're supposed to let God's grace impact our life, and we're supposed to let it go to those that are around us. Maybe you're here today. I don't want you to miss the grace of God. There are some folks here, maybe, that have never trusted Christ as their Savior. They've never placed their faith in Jesus Christ. Don't miss the grace of God. Don't miss it. Don't miss that grace that God has given to you freely. Believers, don't hide the grace of God. Don't hide the grace of God in your life. Let it shine. Let it radiate. Let it beam forth. That grace of God that we don't deserve, and yet He gives to us. Why not just let the grace of God grow in your life? Let it grow. Let's bow together for prayer. Father, Your amazing grace is far beyond anything we could ever imagine. We don't deserve it. We can't earn it. And yet You freely give it. Father, there's one here today that has not rested by faith in Your finished work. I pray that today would be the day that they rest. The heads bowed and eyes closed. Let me ask you this question. Have you placed your faith in Jesus? Maybe you're here today and you say, Brother Rob, I've never trusted by faith. But while you were preaching today, I understood. And I placed my faith in the finished work of Christ. If you did, or maybe even right now while I'm talking, you did, would you just slip your hand up so that I can pray for you and show you the wonders that you have in Christ? Anybody else? I see those hands. Thank you. Amen. Believers, don't hide the grace of God. Grow in His grace. Take Peter's admonition and say, grow in the grace and knowledge of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let God's grace shine. I don't know what's in your life that's hiding God's grace, but you take it to the Lord and ask Him to remove it and let Him just use your life. Father, thank You for Your wonderful grace. Where would we be without the amazing grace? We'd be lost, helpless, without hope. Challenge our hearts, Lord, in this invitation time. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together. We're going to sing this hymn of invitation the second week in a row. It's the amazing grace of God. Let's sing it out.
Shine for God's grace this week. Amen?
Amen?
Let it shine. Let it go forth. Brian, pray for those that are at home, not able to be here, those that are battling different challenges in their lives. And let's pray that God just will use us for His glory this week. Amen?
Amen. Thank you. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for your beautiful grace and mercy and love and kindness you've shown us through your word and through the sacrifice that you made for us on the cross. Father, I pray for those that are at home, those that are sick and suffering, those that are recovering. I pray that you would touch them and heal them, be with them today. I pray for Israel. Lord, I pray that you would heal them, heal their nation. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you.